The following podcast is sponsored by Financial Sense Wealth Management. To learn more about our investment services, go to financialsensewealth.com or give us a call at 888-486-3939. This is the Financial Sense News Hour. Now, here's the Financial Sense News Team.
Stocks are showing signs of short-term weakness as the S&P 500 posted its second consecutive weekly decline. On Tuesday, the Nasdaq briefly reached a new record high for the year, only to reverse those gains with sharp losses on Wednesday and Thursday. Negative investor reactions to earnings from two of the Magnificent Seven tech stocks, Microsoft and Meta, contributed to this pullback. This week also featured important economic reports, including ISM data and data related to the labor markets, both of which could influence interest rates and the Federal Reserve's approach to potential rate cuts. All this and more in this week's market wrap-up. The biggest swing in stocks came on Thursday with deep losses. The Dow Jones Industrial Average fell 0.9%, the S&P 500 fell 1.9%, and the Nasdaq Composite fell 2.8%. Earnings were the big catalyst that contributed to the selling, but there has been some fingers pointing towards rising rates as a contributor to reluctant buying activity as of late. Microsoft fell 6% on the day, while Meta Platforms fell 4.1% on earnings. Another contributor to Thursday's losses came from the semiconductor company Monolithic Power, which fell 17.5%, helping to drive the 4% decline in the Philadelphia Semiconductor Index. Finally, rising yields were yet another catalyst driving the broad weakness in stocks, with the 2-year Treasury yield hitting 4.21 and the 10-year Treasury yield hitting 4.33 in response to a low jobless claims number, higher Q3 employment cost index up 0.8%, and the core PCE price index leveling off at 2.7% year over year for the third month in a row. Microsoft earnings beat by 20 cents and revenue grew 16% year over year. The issue was the company guided below expectations on revenues for the next quarter. Azure, its cloud service, grew 34% in constant currency, which was above consensus, but it guided Azure below this for the next quarter. The personal computing segment did quite well in beating guidance from Activision, Windows, Surface, and Xbox, with game revenue up 43%. The combination of the light guidance and the negative reaction suggests investors were looking for better performance in cloud. However, the company noted that demand continues to be above the company's capacity. Meta delivered a solid quarter, beating earnings estimates by 81 cents on revenue growth of near 19% to $40.6 billion. The company continues to invest aggressively in its cloud infrastructure and in AI, which show positive results in higher time spent in their apps and better ad pricing. Guidance was light, with forecasts for revenue to grow 16% in the next quarter, down from the current 19%. At the same time, the company announced more spending by increasing the bottom range of its CapEx guidance and comments from CEO Zuckerberg that the company isn't slowing down in 2025 either. With the shares up almost 70% for the year and lower revenue guidance, there may not be as much investor tolerance on big spending plans. But it's clear that Meta is convinced that AI and virtual reality will propel its growth, and this quarter's results show that to be the case. Continuing the earnings narrative this week, Alphabet produced a solid earnings report Tuesday evening that was received well on Wednesday by traders. The company beat earnings estimates by 28 cents and beat revenue estimates on higher advertising up 10.4% and cloud revenue up 35%. Unfortunately, the Advanced Micro Devices AMD report didn't help semiconductors, with the stock down 10.6% on softer revenue guidance for the quarter, which seems to be a theme for a lot of AI stocks. Just the day before, Supermicrocomputer was down sharply after its accounting firm Ernst & Young ended its relationship with the company. The company will give an update next week on November 5th on its business operations. It is believed the bottom is in for Intel by some analysts. The company reported better than expected earnings and issued better guidance ahead, with the stock up 7% on these results. The final earnings highlight goes to Amazon and Apple on Friday. Amazon was up nicely after its report, while Apple was trading down most of the day Friday. Amazon reported big gains in revenue, with operating income up 56% year over year, sizable, beating its prior guidance, with revenues up a generous 11%, also above consensus. The company gave an inline revenue target, but had a nice operating income range of $16 to $20 billion compared to the $17.4 billion target it just hit on the quarter. In its cloud services, AWS, the company saw sales up 19%, and the growth has been accelerating. While this holiday season is expected to be the shortest from Black Friday to Christmas Eve since 2019, the company's profitability and solid growth in AWS, its cloud service, allows for investors to largely dismiss the short holiday season ahead. Regarding Apple, I had been reading a lot of mixed analyst reports leading up to the earnings announcement. The soft December quarter revenue guidance was largely to blame for the negative investor response Friday, with the company projecting low to mid single-digit increases to revenue year over year. CEO Tim Cook said that the iOS 18.1 adoption, which has Apple Intelligence, is twice the rate of its iOS 17.1 adoption. The iPhone sales were up 16% year over year to $46.2 billion. Mac sales were up 2%. iPad revenue grew 8%. Wearables fell 3%. And services rose a nice 12% to a record $25 billion. One of the issues has been the delay in all the features for its latest operating system that were shown in September that may be holding consumers back from upgrades. Once these features get released over the next few months, it may drive up demand, which could rectify the letdown investors may be feeling on current estimates. Mixed economic results this week, but the key indicators were largely driving up interest rates, which seems to be weighing on equity bulls. Yields moved higher Tuesday with strong consumer confidence report for October and a strong 7-year note sale. The advance Q3 GDP report also reflected solid growth up 2.8%. with solid component growth, such as the personal consumption expenditures of 3.7%. Turning to jobs data, Wednesday was the ADP private sector payroll estimates, which increased a larger than expected 233,000 in October, with a higher revision to September's numbers. Also Wednesday, the September job openings report showed a decrease to 7.443 million, down from a revised 7.861 million. The following day, initial jobless claims fell 12,000 to 216,000. However, the four-week moving average at 1.87 million was the highest since November 2021. The third quarter employment cost index increased 0.8%, with wages, salaries, and benefit costs rising the same for the previous quarter. Non-farm payrolls increased by just 12,000 announced on Friday. The news came right after the weak ISM manufacturing report, which dropped to 46.5, the lowest reading yet this year. Despite those last two reports, the 10-year Treasury yield rose to 5.35 on the day, putting a lid on the recovery trade Friday. In other news this week, Israel attacked military bases in Iran last weekend because the damage was limited to military targets and not the country's energy infrastructure. Oil fell. The Biden administration believed the attacks would end the tit-for-tat between the two countries, with Iran stating the damage was limited. However, Friday, Iran warned it would retaliate as the damage killed four soldiers and damaged their best air defenses. The U.S. Department of Energy announced new plans to purchase oil for the Strategic Petroleum Reserves on Monday. Next week stands to be another eventful week for the markets. Election Day is Tuesday, November 5th, and the Federal Open Market Committee will announce its policy decision on Wednesday. Decent economic reports, a sticky core PCE price index, and rising rates make next week's Fed meeting an important one after cutting its Fed rate 50 basis points in September. Nobody knows exactly what the Fed's glide path will look like given their surprise move in September. However, the Fed funds futures pricing is pointing to a 98.5% chance of a quarter point cut, according to the CME FedWatch tool. Polling results this week have been pointing towards a very close presidential race next week, so most investors will likely be glued to the TV for most of the day watching the results as they unfold. I'll be back next week to focus on these catalysts and how they move the markets. And if you're curious about why interest rates have been on the rise after the Fed cut rates, I published my big picture article Thursday to my newsletter subscribers titled Grading on the Curve. The article looks at economic results, positive economic surprises, coordinated central bank movements, fiscal spending, interest rate sensitive sectors, and gold. You can also find the article on financialsense.com. Be sure to email me at ryan.paplava@financialsense.com to subscribe to my free newsletter group, handing out these free weekly wrap-ups, monthly practical financial planning articles, and a monthly big picture straight to your email. And do you worry you will outlive your retirement funds? Do you know if you're contributing or withdrawing tax efficiently to or from your savings? Are you sure you're investing prudently according to your plans for retirement? Have you set up an estate plan that guards against probate, litigations, and protects your loved ones? If you can't answer these questions and you're seeking financial planning and investment advisory help with at least $500,000 to invest, feel free to reach out to me at my email, ryan.paplava@financialsense.com, to schedule a free consultation. Up next, this week's guest, Jim Welsh.
There's an interesting article that was actually just posted by James Castories, who joins us today. He is the founder of Investor Acumen and also a prominent author at Seeking Alpha, discussing some of the background info that many of you may not realize about what's going on with the Middle Eastern war and how this is not over. We're going to dive into a lot of this today. It's going to be very informative. So James, the title of the piece, and I'll have a link out to it where this interview is located, Financial Sense, it's called Mideast War Presents Extraordinary Risks and Opportunities After U.S. Presidential Election. I know it's generating a lot of comments and buzz. Let's jump into it. How are you looking at what's happening in the Middle East relative to the U.S. election? Let's start there.
I do think that it is highly probable that the Israelis are going to engage the Iranians in an all-out war sometime in the next few months, because I think they've already made a strategic decision that they need to engage the Iranians now while the Israelis still possess a strategic advantage relative to the Iranians militarily. In other words, the Israelis possess nuclear weapons. The Iranians still don't. The Israelis still have technological and military superiority in many areas. The Iranians are very quickly catching up, but they really haven't quite caught up yet. And I think that basically a lot of the military leadership in Israel and a lot of their political leadership have decided that a military confrontation with Iran is inevitable in the long run. And so if this conflict is inevitable in the long run, they want to have this conflict at a time where they still possess a strategic upper hand.
To listen to this full interview and gain access to all of our premium content airing during the week, where we discuss markets and big investment trends, often well before they reach the mainstream news, go to financialsense.com and hit the subscribe button.
Are you a high-income earner tired of seeing your hard-earned money go to taxes? At Financial Sense Wealth Management, we specialize in working with high-net-worth individuals and businesses to help minimize tax burdens and preserve wealth through proactive financial, retirement, and estate planning. Set up an appointment with one of our advisors today by giving us a call at 888-486-3939. Or visit us on our website, financialsensewealth.com. Advisory services offered through Financial Sense Advisors, a registered investment advisor. Securities offered through Financial Sense Securities, member FINRA SIPC, both companies doing business as Financial Sense Wealth Management.
Well, the inflation rate seems to be in line with much lower rates than expected. What is this meaning for the market on the day it is released at 2.1%? Stocks pull back. Let's find out why. Joining us on the program is Jim Welsh from Macro Tides. Jim, let's begin with the PCE number today, the Fed's favorite inflation number. Let's talk about that and what it means, because rates are backing up. What's going on here?
Well, there's a combination of things that have happened prior to this report, Jim. And, we'll get to that in a minute or two. But the PCE came in as expected, which I think is going to be supportive of the Fed cutting the funds rate another 25 basis points when it meets on November 7th. So this number, I think, will convince even maybe some of the members of the FOMC that might be reluctant to cut rates again. Because on balance, the economic data has been coming in pretty good, with GDP up around 2.8, something like that, not just for last quarter, but in the current quarter. So I think this is a green light for the Fed to act at the next meeting. And the other reason, Jim, is if they don't cut by 25 basis points at the November 7th meeting, it will kind of imply that the 50 basis point cut they made on September 18th was too large. And I think the Fed doesn't want to create that impression. And that's why I really think the odds are they will cut by 25 basis points when they meet next week.
So let's talk about what has happened to the long bond, whether you're looking at 30-year bonds or the 10-year note. It's hard to believe, Jim, we were at 3.6 on the 10-year, and on the day you and I are speaking, it's over 4.3.
Yeah. So in the November issue of Macro Tides, I kind of address this in terms of what happened here. And what I show is a number of factors. First of all, economic stats have been coming in better than forecast. And so there's an index called the Economic Surprise Index, Jim, which basically measures when the actual data comes in, is it above or below forecast? And when the data comes in below forecast, the surprise index declines. And when it comes in above, it rises. And what we've seen consistently since mid-September is most economic point data points have come in better than the forecast. So the surprise index has moved up pretty strongly. And this is classic because I've written about this, you know, a lot over the last year or so. Is now what will happen, Jim, is economists on Wall Street will begin to increase their future expectations for the incoming economic data points. And that creates an environment where it will be easier for the data to come in below expectations. So it's the yin-yang. But what I've shown is the 10-year and 30-year treasury yields really have a high correlation with swings in the economic surprise index. So that's one thing that has lifted treasury yields by, you know, 70 basis points exactly from the day that the Fed cut the funds rate. The other thing is the term premium, which is the excess return that bond investors expect for holding longer term paper. Also, the uncertainty of where the economy and inflation is going. And back in September, term premium was like minus 45 basis points. Well, now it's plus 45 basis points. So you've seen this big swing in the term premium, in part because economic stats came in better. People are concerned or thinking that Trump is going to win the election. And there's been a lot of reports coming out, oh my gosh, if he wins, the deficit's going to be even bigger, and his trade policy is going to cause inflation. So all these things have combined, Jim, to cause treasury yields to rise fairly significantly. Now, back in mid-September, I was expecting treasury yields to go up. And, you know, my subscribers were long TLT from around 91, and we had a stop in at 99.69, and it got triggered on the day that the Fed lowered the funds rate. So technically, there were signs that we were also going to see treasury yields tick higher, and then the fundamentals have kind of filled in the blanks. So that's how we got to where we are right now.
Speaking of fundamentals, I want to talk about something you talk in the latest Macro Tides. And you cite bank credit analysts have a different way of looking at employment.
Yep.
And if you look at their measure, the unemployment rate is much higher than it's currently reported. And they you highlighted that you take a look at these job numbers that look really strong. But if you take a look at the Department of Labor, government jobs increased by 785,000. You back out government jobs and the unemployment rate would be higher.
Yes. Now, you're making two points, so let me address the second one first, because what I wrote about after the September employment report came out was that the unemployment rate dropped from 4.2 to 4.1. There are two surveys, the establishment survey, which asks businesses what's going on with your employment status, and then a second survey, the household survey, that asks people, hey, what's happening with you? And the household survey is the one that's used to determine the unemployment rate. So I went back to 2017. And what you can see, Jim, is in September, as we all know, if you've had kids going to school, you know, teachers go back to school in September. If high school and college kids maybe were working over the summer, well, they stop working, they go back to school. So there's a lot of ebb and flow that takes place every single September. And the Labor Department uses seasonal adjustments to try to smooth this stuff out. So going back to 2017, Jim, and excluding 2020 because of the pandemic, so you have 6 years of data, the seasonal adjustment, the largest add that it had ever done was 50,000 jobs. And so 785,000 were, you know, kind of theoretically created in September of 2024. And because of that, the unemployment rate went from 4.2 to 4.1 instead of going from 4.2 to 4.3. Now, you know, it's just a coincidence that this number is coming out a month before the election and all the rest of it. But that just to me jumped out as being, wow, this is kind of extraordinary. The bank credit analysts, as you noted, uses state data, and which is kind of a different way, but kind of a cool way of, you know, kind of like what's happening in all these states. They adjusted for the population in the states and so forth. And the unemployment rate ticked up from 4 to 4.3 based on their model. So for me, that was like confirmation of some of the things that I had written about back in September. And it just kind of says, wait, we're getting this impression that the labor market is really, really in good shape. And this kind of stuff suggests, you know what, it's okay. It's not falling apart by any means, but it isn't quite as strong as the official headlines would suggest.
Well, that's also too, because one of the things that we see consistently, you'll have a strong jobs number that's reported at the beginning of the month. But then they'll say, oh, we're revising the previous month's lower. And then, of course, Jim, we had that major correction by the Labor Department where they basically said that jobs were overstated by, what was it, something like over 800,000 jobs. Yeah. So these job numbers, you got to take them with a grain of salt. They don't necessarily reflect what they are when they're reported.
Well, and the thing is, Jim, is all those revisions don't garner the same kind of headlines as the original report does. And over time, looking at the direction of revisions kind of is supporting evidence of the overall health of the labor market. So back in 22 and 23, most of the revisions were to the upside. Over the last year, most of the revisions have been to the downside. And as you noted, the annual revision was very substantial. I mean, it lowered the number of jobs by a third that had been originally reported. So again, I think, you know, for most investors, and I'm talking about, you know, Wall Street, they look at the headline and very rarely go beyond the headline and look at some of the details. And that's one of the things I try to do, because I think it provides context to some of the numbers. And when the two don't agree, then you have, you know, valuable information. And I think that's what you and I are talking about, is valuable information from the standpoint of the labor market is okay. It's not as strong as we're being told that it is. And in part, that has, I think, contributed. The last employment report was one of the things that helped boost Treasury yields to go higher. So we'll see. The next number comes out on Friday, November 1st. So, you know, there's always two numbers. Well, what's the number and what was the revision for the last 2 months?
I want to talk about something else that is also reflected in the political polls, and that's consumer confidence. Mm-hmm. If, you know, the Harris campaign are complaining, look, this is really a great economy. The job market's strong. People should be feeling better, but they aren't. And that's, you can see that in the consumer confidence index. What's your take on that?
Well, you know, my take was that last month it dropped fairly, it dropped a lot, which to me didn't agree with really the overall level of economic growth that we're currently enjoying. And then yesterday they did come out with the latest update and consumer confidence rebounded. So it went like from 105 to 98 up to 108. So there's a fair amount of volatility here. I think the point that you bring out, the frustration of the Harris campaign, is that, gee, the economy seems to be doing all right, but these people just don't get it. Well, unfortunately, those people are living day to day. They're the ones going to the grocery store, trying to make the family budget stretch. Rent for a lot of folks, you know, has gone up very significantly, more than what their wages have. Insurance, if they have a car, has gone up very significantly. So for, I'd say, the bottom 40% of workers in this country, you know, they're feeling economic pressure. And on balance, that's why President Biden, consistently got low marks regarding the economy. So you can talk about, yeah, the unemployment rate's low, but for a lot of people, the cost of living has gone up so much. And that's where the rubber meets the road for most people. I got a paycheck. How's it, you know, handling the increases in costs that I'm experiencing? And the answer is, for a lot of people, it's tough. And I think that's why on the ground, Jim, a lot of people have a different view of how the economy is performing relative to the people up in the ivory tower.
You know, another thing, and I wonder if this reflects it as well, a bifurcated economy. If you have, you make enough money, you have a 401k, you have assets, you own a home, you've seen your home go up in value, your 401k is going up in value, stocks are going up. But if you aren't as fortunate to have like a 401k program, you're in the poor or let's say lower middle class where you don't have assets to appreciate with inflation, you're exactly what you're talking about. You're just trying to make ends meet every month. I mean, I do the grocery shopping for my family, and I'm always shocked at the price of meat, fish, yeah, all kinds of things that, you know, we're looking at prices, like meat prices almost have doubled if yeah, you're buying like a high quality grass-fed beef.
Right.
And I wonder how much of that is reflected in terms of what are happening to people that don't have assets.
Yeah, well, I think we know the answer to that, Jim. There is bifurcation in the economy, and those with assets have enjoyed the huge run up, 45 to 50%. I think the median home price has gone up. Equity portfolios have improved and gone up. So, you know, again, for most of those folks who don't have a house, they're renting. Well, the rent's gone up a lot. They don't have an equity portfolio to really, goose their net worth. So, yeah, this bifurcation is, serious. And again, it's one of the longer term problems that our country is going to have to deal with and work to eradicate to some extent, the inequality of wealth and inequality of income. I mean, some of these things are back to where they were like in the 1920s. And so we do need to figure out a way to address those subjects. And, you know, my take has been, is given that the economy has benefited from the appreciation of assets, it almost says, well, what happens if those assets decline in value? And at some point in time, we are going to see a recession. I think the economy is not quite as robust as people think. I think next year is going to be problematic for a lot of different reasons. But if and when we see a 20 to 30% decline in equity prices and home prices start to sag, it's going to have an impact on those upper incomes. So now you'll have both ends of the bifurcation under the gun. And I think that it's a question of when that comes, Jim, not if.
I want to move on to a final topic, and that is gold. It got up to $2,758. We were just about ready to break through to $2,800. It's pulled back. Silver got over 30, almost to $35 an ounce. What's your take on where gold and silver stand at this point?
Well, in this last Monday's weekly technical review, which is going to be, I believe, available when this gets posted, I have thought that gold was near a high and that a decline below 2650, maybe closer to 2600, was coming. And that was based on positioning. A lot of people have gotten bullish and long gold and at levels that in the past have preceded corrections. Technically, gold was making these higher price highs, gems, but various momentum indicators were reaching lower levels. In other words, like a ball you throw up in the air, you know, it leaves your hand. And we'll make believe for a second that leaves our hand as we throw the ball up, Jim, and it's going 100 miles an hour. But at some point in time, it's going 30, 20, 10, still going up. So these momentum indicators are measuring the rate of change of the increase in altitude, if you will. And what they're indicating is that in the last 2 weeks or so, the upswing in the price is running out of gas. That typically is what precedes a pullback. Chart-wise, that area around 2,600 should be supportive. Longer term, I think after a correction, and this has been my view all this year, after a correction, we were going to see higher highs in gold, and I think that still applies.
All right. Well, given what you see right now, I think there's still a lot of uncertainty. We're looking at interest rates, some of these job numbers that we've been talking about, confidence. You've got the election itself. Final question. After next Tuesday, hopefully we'll know who's going to be sitting in the White House. Do you think that calms some of this volatility? Because now the market, the people have spoken. We know what the outcome is.
Maybe. I think there's a high likelihood, Jim, that when the results of the election are known, and unless one candidate performs well, way beyond what the polls are suggesting, we probably won't know for a number of days. I mean, states like Pennsylvania don't even begin to count mail-in votes until the election day. And we're talking about probably 3 million votes that need to be counted. So I think there's going to be a lag in terms of when the outcome is truly known. The problem and the risk, I think, is both parties, I think, are ready to contest the election. In 2020, we saw President Trump say it was stolen. Well, people forget in 2016, Hillary Clinton held most of the leadership of the Democratic Party, called Trump an illegitimate president. That election was stolen because of the Russians or whatever else. So I think, Jim, there's a real risk that however this election turns out, the losing party is not going to handle it gracefully, which, kind of takes away from what you're talking about. Gee, once that's behind us, we have some degree of certainty, at least about that subject. It may not go quite that smoothly. So, that makes me very concerned about, okay, we get the election over, but is anything really going to change fundamentally? Are we going to make progress on various problems? I'm very skeptical of that. Saddened, but skeptical.
Yeah, we've basically, Jim, we've changed the way we go through these elections. You used to be able on election night, who the clear winner is, but they've changed the rules. Good examples, our own state of California, where it's now illegal to ask for ID at a voting poll.
So you're right. All the way we're doing this undermines the integrity of elections, but also people's confidence in, how they're being held. One thing I'll make, because I find this interesting, in India, the election day is a national holiday. If you vote, you get paid as if you worked. If you don't vote, you don't get paid. And I really believe something like that would be an important step forward, and it would allow us to increase the integrity of our elections. But unfortunately, we're not there, and we're going to have to deal with the points that you're making. And again, I think both sides are going to cry foul if they're on the losing end of the election.
All right, Jim. Well, listen, as we close, I think the gist of what you're saying is there are a lot of macro factors that are driving higher interest rates. We've got a lot of other factors that are creating this volatility up 1 week, down the next week, et cetera. If our listeners would like to find out more about Macro Tides, tell them how they could do so.
Well, two things. Go to macrotides.com and you'll be able to check some additional information out. If you want to receive the November issue of Macro Tides, send me an email, jimwelshmacro@gmail.com, and I'll send it out and you'll see some additional information that goes into more detail on top of the conversation you and I just had.
All right. Well, listen, Jim, as always, it's a pleasure speaking with you, and I look forward to speaking with you again.
That concludes our weekend edition of the Financial Sense News Hour. To speak with our financial planning and wealth management team, give us a call at 888-486-3939. Or you can also visit us on our website, financialsensewealth.com. If you aren't already a subscriber to our weekday podcast and would like to listen to more of our content where we regularly interview book authors, industry experts, and market strategists from around the globe, go to financialsense.com and hit the subscribe button.
On behalf of Financial Sense NewsHour and the Financial Sense Wealth Management Team, we hope you have a pleasant weekend.
Financial Sense News Hour is for informational and educational purposes only and should not be considered as a solicitation or offer to purchase or sell any securities. The investments, investment strategies, and investment philosophies discussed or presented on the News Hour each involve their own unique risk factors, which are not discussed on the show. Responses to listener inquiries are based on the personal opinions of the Financial Sense staff and do not take into account listener suitability, objectives, or risk tolerance. Financial Sense News Hour and its parent company shall not be liable for any financial losses that result from investing in any companies mentioned in Financial Sense or arising out of the use of any material on the News Hour. Be advised that you invest at your own risk.